Listen, Jason, before we do this podcast, I'm going to need some hot chocolate and some pecan pie. Some
fucking pecan pie.
I don't like it's I was sitting there looking at Affleck's career and like
I was too.
Just kind of trying to figure out the kind of the ebb and flow of it. Right. Because he is in indie shit for a minute. And like, and look, he's been trying to do his own career for a really long time. Yeah. For Good Will Hunting and really blows up, right? And more successfully than probably Damon was. I mean, Damon had Courage Under Fire, and that was really. And then of course, School Ties. But
what they were both in.
What they were both in. But I guess you could call it. You know, they weren't. They still weren't like getting. Anyway, to the point. His shit's like really bizarre because he goes from Armageddon into like rom-com-y stuff and then superhero stuff. And then he just kind of like goes from a good role to, and I know that they make fun of this when they're talking about, in I think Jay and Silent Bob Strike Back. They make fun of like, it's a one for them, two for the studio kind of thing. And I know, here's the thing, my take on Affleck is I think that he is almost too smart to be an actor, like, and to be like a really well-ranged actor. I think that guy really gets it. I think he gets the industry. I think he knows how to write. I think he knows how to really direct. He's just not that good. Like, if you give him a stoic role where there's not a lot of emotional range, I don't think he's built to carry a film.
No, think about how good he is in something like The Town.
Right.
Where
right.
he just kind of lets everyone else circle around him and do this like great work. And he's kind of there as like the name at the center of everything. But everyone else, like Renner, is stealing scenes. Right. John Hamm is being John Hamm. But like everyone right. else is doing that work. Right. Blake Lively. Right. Is putting on some kind of like Southie accent. I'm not sure. But look,
can we just say that Blake Lively's done at this point? Like,
what else does she need to do?
Right, right. No, it's fine. Look, I'm sure she's a wonderful person.
She's fun to hang out with.
I'm sure she is. Yeah, I bet it's great. I bet it's great. All the free vodka you can have. It's fine. But name me a movie where Affleck is the sole center of it.
Right.
That's good. That's right. that where he can carry it. Like even in something like Armageddon, which, you know, we can debate whether or not it's a fine popcorn film. I think it's fine.
Sure.
But he has a similar kind of affectation. I'm sorry.
That was so good.
That was great. In that movie as compared to the one we're going to be talking about today. Yeah. But it's such a limited quantity. Right. And you can also focus on the star power that is. You know, Bruce Willis in that case, who can carry a film.
Right.
Affleck, I think it's good that, and I think it took him a while. And obviously I think there's a lot of ego involved in a young, a young star in Hollywood. And I was thinking about this as well. It's like, you know, I talked about it last time about how there are really no like stars that came out of the 90s indie scene, but maybe you could argue that Affleck and Damon might've been, they weren't really indie darlings, but they did come out of, I don't know if you want to call it kind of a hard scrabble, like doing Smith stuff and doing their Gus Van Sant, you know. And I mean, so there's an argument to be made that those two could be your poster boys for 90s art house. Although I would say that they're later, probably late 90s, early 2000s.
Yeah. And I think you were really talking more early to mid 90s than you were later. Because it does seem almost like a different era at that point.
Right.
And it almost seems like somebody like a Chris O'Donnell was one who didn't sort of take off from that.
Right.
Because he was sort of in that, like.
Yeah, in that. He was such a fucking piece of cardboard, though.
Oh, I know. Like, I wasn't saying.
like O'Donnell to me was always like the poster boy for just like Nickelback. Like he's the Nickelback of actors, right? I mean, it's just like the most middling horse shit you could possibly. It's just fine. Yeah. Look, it's fine to have, you know, a McDonald's hamburger every once in a while. But you don't want that being Robin in your fucking Batman and Robin movies.
But you just like, you're mixing your metaphors here,
yes,
right?
Yes, I know.
What you meant to say was, it's okay to listen to Nickelback ironically.
No, it's not. Well, one, okay, yes, But it's not okay to even like Chris O'Donnell, ironically. Okay. Like, there was a point in time where I think if you grew up on the Spice Girls and, like, and you might have had a Chris O'Donnell poster.
Sure.
But, like, everything that he, yeah, he's just awful. Right. He is the worst.
Right. You're saying that Scent of a Woman was not.
No, I am saying that. Look, and if what, you know, for what, as much Philip Seymour Hoffman as that movie gave us, what an overblown pile of crap that movie actually is. Like, and it's so weird. It's like, it's so, that movie's so apologetic for, like, we're going to finally give Pacino something. And like, we're going to, like, because that era of Pacino, and one, we don't take enough blame for the bullshit that we encourage, and then it grows on itself.
Oh, right.
So, like, we give Pacino does he get the Oscar for that? He gets the Oscar for that, right? Yeah. And then now, every fucking role that Pacino does is hoo-ah, let me die. He's got a great big ass, and your head's all the way up it.
Show me what you got.
It's just, he becomes a parody of himself to the point where he's doing the Al Pacino cappuccino thing on fucking whatever that, the Jack and Jill movie. And then, like, it's just shit that he, I mean, like, you just become a joke at that point. And I like, it's the same. We do this over and over and over again where we encourage a certain set of behavior, and then we're all appalled by it when it continues. And this is what happens when we allow Chris O'Donnell and Al Pacino to be in a movie together. God, thank God that Philip Seymour Hoffman was able to rise above that and come out unscathed.
Well,
but I mean, he's dead now. Rest in peace.
So.
I mean, you know, it's a fucked up world out there, man. I mean, Hall and Oates are fighting. It's a fucking, it's just, it's crazy.
Yeah,
right?
I know. And I'm still not sure which one's which.
I have no idea.
I mean, when one is talking about rock and soul, it's, it's oftentimes, okay, Screamers. Today it's a two-part Christmas extravaganza episode. In part one, we are talking the latest Fort Worth Film Club screening, Smoke Signals. And then it's time for our Christmas grab bag. In Santa's knapsack are Rare Exports, The Silent Partner, The Christmas That Almost Wasn't, and Reindeer Games. And then stick around for part two, where it's gift exchange time. Jason has gifted to me the films A Reason to Believe and The Lost Skeleton of Cadavra, and I have wrapped and put under the tree for Jason A Woman Kills and Saint Omer. Ho, 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 and
four
mistletoe,
four wildly
and
movies.
Presents for good little girls.
I like that.
Merry Christmas.
That you were worried about, or like you were unsure of the pronunciation of Cadavra. So I know that you haven't seen it. So I'm good with that.
You like how I just like looked at you when I said Cadavra. Cadavra. I didn't even practice that before we got
there. But that's not today. Today is the our five films we're going to talk about. You want to jump into the Smoke Signals?
Yeah, let's start with Smoke Signals, the latest Fort Worth Film Club screening. And I'm always going to worry that I'm going to get that, like, mixed up again.
Good morning, this is Randy Pion on KRES Radio. It's a good day to be indigenous.
Let's go to Lester Falls apart at the KRES traffic van, broken down at the crossroads since 1972.
Ain't no traffic, really.
Watch where you're going! Jeez!
Hey, Victor, you need a ride?
Yeah.
What are you gonna trade for it? We're Indians, remember? We barter.
Thomas, you gotta look like a warrior.
First of all, quit grinning like an idiot. Indians ain't supposed to smile like that. Get stoic. You gotta look like you just came back from killing a buffalo.
But our tribe never hunted buffalo. We were fishermen.
This ain't Dances with Salmon, you know?
When Victor's father walked out 10 years ago, he left behind a burning secret that consumed his family. Now, Victor is about to leave the reservation for the first time.
You guys got your passports?
But it's the United States.
That's as foreign as it gets.
On a search for the ways of his tribe.
Thomas! I'm going for help!
The importance of family. And the truth about his father.
I know how it started.
Nobody knows how it started.
Victor. He went back for you.
Smoke signals.
You guys are heroes, you know? It's like you're the Lone Ranger and Tonto.
It's more like we're Tonto and Tonto.
Arnold rescued Thomas from a fire when he was a child. Thomas thinks of Arnold as a hero, while Arnold's son, Victor, resents his father's alcoholism, violence, and abandonment of his family. This is, and we should say, this is in a film from 1998 with an all indigenous director, writer, producers.
Right. Yeah. Yeah. And mostly cast. And
most cast. Too, yeah. But right. I was almost going to say that. I'm like, well, no, there's some,
there's quite a few extras and additional pieces that are
super minor characters.
Right. 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 People they meet on the way. Overall thoughts on Smoke Signals?
I
mean, it's an audience award winner from 1997 at Sundance, as well as a Filmmakers Award, nominated for the Grand Jury Prize, didn't win. I have no idea what won that year, but it doesn't matter.
I think this is it's an easy movie to like.
Right.
I think it's a pretty crowd-pleasing film. It may be a touch too sentimental for me in places, but I think largely I enjoy it because of Thomas and his portrayal by Evan Adams. I think that is the real thing that carries the film for me, is how enigmatic and sort of charismatic he is in this movie.
The one thing that struck me about watching it last night was how for an 89-minute movie, it doesn't really move that swiftly. I don't want to denigrate it, because I do like the too much. I do like the film. Let me quantify. I do
stay on brand.
I do really like the film. And when I first saw it, I think I was just like everyone else, enamored with Thomas. Right. I mean, like we said last night that and I don't think we mentioned either that the one thing we didn't mention last night, where I think how well done the kids' roles actually pretty are in that movie. And like, one, they got kids that looked like the adults, which is, I think, I mean, was a bonus in their part. But I do think that Chris Eyre does a good job with those kids and their acting ability, pushing them to do just enough to kind of convey that emotion, which is not easy for either one of those kids, that kind of wide-eyed innocence and kind of like bottled up anger that Victor has. But I do think that it's hard to walk away from this movie and not, especially as the emotion crescendos, right? I mean, like, I do think it starts off a little slow, and I do think it starts off a little angry, because you're kind of in Victor's headspace. So by the time it hits the midpoint and you're really kind of like, by the time they get to Phoenix and they're off the bus and they're kind of walking, and it's that whole really start. Thomas starts to come into his own about kind of, you start to see more about his poetry and how he looks at the world and how he just kind of like takes on the barbs that are thrown at him without fighting back at all, and which is what he's done his entire life. I think it's hard to walk away from this movie and not at least fall in love with that character.
Yeah.
I do agree with you that it is, I don't think it, you know, 25 years later, I don't think it holds up as, I don't think it's as strong as a movie as, and it's because you've seen other things like we've talked about last night, as far as Reservation Dogs and things like that, where you've kind of seen a building upon that this foundation that Smoke Signals lays out. But I do think that, the Thomas character and Evan Adams, and it's a shame that Evan really didn't have the career that he probably deserved after this, and kind of blowing up after this, because he's so good. And he's got that great, I mean, both Adam Bach and Evan have this, Is it Adam Beach? I didn't say Bach.
Beach, right?
Yeah. Adam Beach, they both have this great look to them. And it's interesting that Evan really didn't ever do, at least as far as I know, didn't do much after this.
Yeah, I was kind of looking and he didn't do a whole lot. Kind of bit pieces here and there. I think a lot more indigenous stuff. I mean, which is not
sure to
say, but I mean, I think... And it's interesting, too, that a lot of the actors in Smoke Signals have gone on to do a lot of, you know, mainly indigenous-produced, indigenous, you know, directed work, right? I don't mean interesting, but I think that sort of tells us what they really are interested in and care about doing.
Sure. But I do think it's kind of treacly in times. I do think that the story is overly simplistic in some cases. And I do think that the comedy undermines its serious throughput, you know, its through line quite a bit. And I don't mean the comedy from Thomas. I think there's some of the comic pieces that they put in. I think that some of the interactions they have with the non-Indigenous characters too, don't translate that well. I don't necessarily know when I start thinking about this, like how I would make this movie better, how I would do it. But like, it feels like this movie wants to be a couple of things. It wants to be a family drama and it wants to be a road movie. And I think maybe if you take the road movie aspect out of it, and really focus on like, because what we get kind of cheated out of is really Victor's realization of what Thomas is bringing to the table and bringing to their relationship. It only happens after the car wreck where they are, trying to save, these two girls that have been in this wreck and it's been created by this drunk driver and the mom from Beverly Hills 90210. And Will Ferrell's wife in Old School, who's Amy. she was actually also in Kicking and Screaming, was the first time I ever saw her. I think it really should have been more of a buddy movie and more of like a, like say a, I mean, like if you want to make it Midnight Run, make it Midnight Run.
Make it Rain Man.
Right, exactly. Otherwise, let's focus on these two characters coming together and getting to know each other. I don't think you need a huge, like, I don't think you need to kick Thomas's character to like shake Victor or like, or come.
No,
I do think focusing on them and like, I do think you need to take them out of their element a little bit so Victor can get that. But I wish the story had been more of a focus on maybe Victor and Thomas and Susie, like all of them trying to kind of, this would have been a great, like, if you would have done that and made it just like a stage play kind of like put them a state over where you're not like worried about that bus trip. Because really the bus trip doesn't add anything to you. You get the one interaction with the gymnast and you get the one interaction with the two asshole cowboys. With this is my gun cleaning hat kind of bullshit. And like, and so to that end, like, I don't, it, that gives you John Wayne's teeth, but that doesn't give you really anything else. And so like, there, all of that communication that happened and that back and forth and this could have been done as you got to Susie's place. And there's more dynamic there between the three of them. And it's hard to badmouth this movie just because it's, like I said, it is so winning. I mean, it's just so easy to watch and to take on. But I do think that, it might waste a little bit of time. And like I said, like you were talking about too, about how the short story has additional characters. If you had incorporated those additional characters instead of pulling out, like if you had given us more of the characters on the res, right? I know you need a separation of Victor's dad from the situation, so they have to kind of bond together. But if you gave us more of information on the res and then getting them over to, you know, Victor's dad's new location, you could have made it. I mean, again, I'm not going to sit there and pick it all apart, but I do think that's one of the things the story misses, is that there's not like Victor's path, through this movie, his emotional path to this movie only really comes in like the last 10 minutes. And then we're kind of left with, a really, really touching moment. I mean, and I think that's what, and I think this film does what it really does really well. And I think why it wins the audience award is because all of the good stuff is in the back end of the movie, like all of the poetry, all of the, what do we forgive our fathers for? That's that whole part really is really great. That last voiceover of Thomas is fucking brilliant. Yeah. But I want more of that throughout the entire thing.
Right. I mean, one of the moments that I really, I think there are a lot of choices in this film that we can question, right? And right. I think, not that we're tearing it down, but we are saying, I wonder why like this choice was made, because one of the moments that I love is when they are walking to, Victor's father's trailer and Thomas is like, boy, that's all we do is walk. Columbus shows up on the shore, we have to go away. Custer shows up, we go this way. We build a house on the moon. And to your point, this shows us how Thomas sees the world, but through this kind of, storyteller's eyes, poet's eyes, and he's always grinning as he says it, which, I mean, in a way tells us that he just knows more than everybody.
Right.
He understands this kind of cynical world in a way that he can still laugh at it. Right. But that's where that stuff is so interesting, right? That, yeah, like more of that kind of interaction. Let Victor play off. It's like they never really seem to kind of play back and forth.
Right.
They're always sort of isolated, even when they're together. When Victor's being a complete dick, it's still just such an isolated.
Yeah, this needs to be more Odd Couple, right?
I mean, right.
And I do think, and let me ask you this, you feel like this, like the movie, like kind of robs Thomas of a lot of his agency, right?
Yes.
I think they kind of like play him like a Rain Man, right? I mean, they play him like an innocent kind of boob, where Victor's this like hardened, and I get that that's the path that they've laid out for themselves. Well, not like that Victor's laid out for himself, but I do think it's a little unfair to paint Thomas as this Pollyanna
and like a simpleton,
right? Because he's not. And I think that there would have been a better reveal. I think it's easy to fall in love with him, but I think it would have been a better reveal. And I know, like I said, I don't think Thomas ever needs to lose that level of innocence or that level. But I do think that at some point there needed to be some sort of acknowledgement that Thomas is the more emotionally mature one here. He's the one and you get it a little bit. But again, when his grandmother touches his face and it says, you know, tell us what happened. Tell me what happened to Thomas. Tell me what's gonna happen. I think it's a really powerful moment, but I think it comes too late.
Right.
To like,
because I'm sorry, I want to just like add to that or interrupt there, because like at a certain point in the film for whatever reason portrays the two of them as like grinning idiots.
Yeah.
Right. Thomas and his grandmother is just these two smiling idiots who look exactly alike. And I'm like, I've seen this a handful of times, and each time I'm like, why do they do that?
Yeah.
Like, why? Because when we first meet Thomas's grandmother, she's not acting like that.
Right. And she's screaming at him, right? I mean, screaming at Arnold, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's only later that now they both have the same braids and the same glasses and the same kind of like goofy grin on their face.
And I think you lean into the sweetness of all of that. Mm-hmm. But I do think that that line that tell me what's gonna happen, Thomas. Mm-hmm. Like there are just moments in this movie. And maybe it's just, maybe the movie is asking more of the audience than what I'm giving it credit for. But I do think it's a little bit like, I think it needed to treat its audience a little dumber and explain it a little bit more, because like the lines that they give Thomas, and I think this comes through probably in the writing and not the actual execution of the movie, but you know, in the movie, or I'm sorry, in the writing, and in when they're all sitting around in Susie's cabin or in a camper, and she says, you know, what do you want? You want lies or truth? And Thomas is like, I want them both. I mean, that's the good. Both are important. I mean,
you can't really have one without the other.
Right. Right. And so that line, and then tell me what's going to happen, Thomas, it's so wonderful. And I think, again, they come at such points that are so understated that like, I feel like we should be walking away thinking that, oh, we completely misunderstood. And then wanting to go back and look at Thomas's his path again, and really watch his character and go, oh shit, he already knew X, Y, and Z when he came on. He knew that Victor was needed this. This is why he's it's why he is actually at the place, because he knows Victor's going to go cash the check. That's why he's in the convenience store there to meet Victor. And like, he's the guy who's driving this. It's not Victor pulling Thomas along or begrudgingly pulling Thomas along. It is Thomas. It's always been Thomas. It's been the entire time. That's why, you know, potentially it's why Arnold still had a relationship even as long as he did with Victor. And that, you know, again, that he's been protecting him all along. There should have been that kind of reveal. And as much as we probably would have hated that too, to be honest.
Yeah, probably. Well, and you know, in the short story, that idea, because it's there in the short story where Thomas goes with him because Arnold has told Thomas, watch out for Victor,
right?
Part of your job is to take care of Victor. So he goes on this trip on one hand because of that. And then that comes up through a discussion that we never really get in the film, which is this like resentment. that Victor has for Thomas of Arnold being in some ways more of a father to Thomas than he was to Victor.
Right.
And so then that like reveal, right, becomes more interesting when he talks about like, yeah, I went to the Spokane Falls that one time and I saw your dad and this is what he told me. Like we were talking and this is what he told me.
Right.
And so then that gives a little more gravity to that situation. But like we never really get that relationship fleshed out either. Speaking of relationships that we don't get fleshed out, okay, I'm a little confused as to Susie's point in this movie. Because she's there for like this long, but she is front and center on the poster.
Right. I do think that's, yeah.
And the poster is such a misdirect for this film, too.
It really is, yeah. And there's a lot of like cheapness given to the cheapness. I shouldn't necessarily use that word, but there it seems like they skimped a lot on the promotion of this film and like the papyrus, like
I know the fonts.
I mean, it's like there's a lot of it that like is just a little again too on the nose in a lot of cases. But yeah, that's another thing that again, had you had more time with Susie, you could have fleshed because again, you kind of see. There's a hint of attraction between Arnold and Susie, and there's a hint of attraction between Victor and Susie, and that makes sense. And you give her such a pivotal moment in the film where she burns Arnold's, you know, camper as the last moments of the movie. Mm-hmm.
Well, and she's responsible for Victor starting that kind of like grieving healing process as well.
Right. Yeah. So, yeah, I mean, it's like I said, I would never, it is a very nice, like, crowd pleasing film, mm-hmm. and it's and it one you will watch and say, why are Brock and Jason such assholes about it? But which is a good question.
What have you come to expect from us? Right?
It's a question we ask ourselves every single day. So
I just accept it at this point.
So
I'm old enough. I'm not going to fucking change.
Right? No, me either. No. But I do think. And I think it'll be kind of a film that people point to just because of its place in history.
Yeah.
But I do think that as we get further and further away from it, there are probably better examples of a truly representation of indigenous culture that we can point to. And for its importance and its place in time, that's great. And I said, it is a good, solid film. There are things you're going to walk away from it and you're going to fall in love with some of the characters, which you should. I just think there's a little bit that is left to be wanting from the end product.
And like I said, I mean, you know, we can question choices, you know, why this, why that.
Right.
Whatever. So, but yeah, go watch it. Enjoy it. And then come back to us and go like, wow, you guys you're onto something there. Okay, let's dig into Santa's old grab bag there, Jason.
Hell yeah, let's do it.
Now, we have a choice. Would you like to just use the spinner?
Let's just spin it around.
All right. Are you ready?
Ooh, look at that. People are going to think we actually bought money on a spinner.
All right, the first film is going to be The Silent Partner.
All right.
1978, which I could not, for whatever reason, I kept thinking it was like 72.
Really?
I never, 78 felt like too late in my mind.
It does
feel
like an entrenched 70s thriller, right?
Oh, yeah.
It feels like it's got the grain.
But it's also in Toronto. True, Canada is technically like 10 years behind us, so that was probably why I thought 72.
But yeah, it does feel like it does feel like an early 70s film.
It does.
Yeah, it has that kind of like the look and feel of the aesthetic, just the entire aesthetic of like, because you're coming like a lot of the like. Set dressing looks like it's coming from just straight out of like late 60s.
Right.
So, you know, so it's interesting that it is on the cusp of the 80s. Yeah.
Of Reaganomics.
Do you want to give us a rundown?
Yeah. A timid bank teller anticipates a bank robbery and steals the money himself before the crook arrives. When the sadistic crook realizes he's been fooled, he tracks down the teller and engages him in a cat and mouse chase for the cash. This movie is so sexy. So sexy. And also, Plummer has never been so sinister. He is so, so sinister and in this film. Oh my God. It's like he's got eyeliner on. And I'm just like,
I think he does.
I think he probably does. Yeah. But I mean, and he was like, what, 49 at that point? Or like somewhere like late 40s, on the cusp of 50. But man.
Plummer and Malcolm McDowell, are two guys I think people forget how like attractive they were. And the, I mean, like, not that they're not attractive older men, but like when they were young and not even young, but like when they were dudes, like, well, Malcolm McDowell, if you watch him in like, if it's like, I mean, it's not even like, a question, right. Like he's just crazy. I'd be like,
right.
I know he's been around for a while, but like go out and watch Get Crazy and tell me how like awesomely, but Plummer in this with his fucking blonde, beautiful hair and like his just, his, I don't know, his physique and like, it's just
the way he moves and looks at, oh man. Yeah.
It's crazy to me then too, that I guess that, you know, these guys are character actors and they've done, you know, they've been in the system for a really long time, but like, it's weird to me that these guys aren't leading men, like really lead, like Michael Caine or like even Elliot Gould. Like, I mean, like how do Caine and Gould, and again, I love both of those guys.
Right.
I really love Gould. How does Gould negotiate a leading man career in the 70s and not Plummer, someone like Plummer?
I know. Do you think that like Plummer fell into the category? You brought up Malcolm McDowell, and I don't think Plummer looks like Malcolm McDowell, but I always feel like Malcolm McDowell, Terrence Stamp, and Udo Kier just are like the same kind of the same kind of person, just like they're the small
70s like, version of Dylan McDermott and Dermot Mulroney.
Yeah, they're like just a little, you know, Stamp's a little taller,
right?
You know, but yeah, I don't know.
Had you seen this before?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
And this was one of like I went back and watched the Siskel and Ebert episode where this is on, and they did a couple of episodes on it because they did one of like lost films of the 70s or for not necessarily lost, but like underseen things of the 70s, and this was one of them that they did. But there was one that when they did their episode about this one, when it came to Chicago for the first time, they were like, you know, it didn't do well wherever it was before, but it's doing well here and people are liking it, but people are not going to be able to see it because it's going to go away. And they were like begging people to go see it. I saw this a couple of years ago and I keep coming back to it. It is such a fucking banger. I mean, this is
so
good.
And
like, this is written by Curtis Hanson, you know, so like it has credentials, and actually part of it was directed by Curtis Hanson, because by the time, I guess the Duke, whoever it was, Daryl Duke walked off because of creative differences, but like, it's, you know, and I know that The Long Goodbye and Bob and Carol and Ted and Alice, and there's a lot of like Gould stuff that's out there. This one just seems to be, like I said, kind of a hidden in the rough, kind of a diamond in the rough kind of movie that people don't talk about very much, but it is so damn good. And like, it's as a pot boiler, like it's for an hour and 45. You move from piece to piece into like, and it just continually escalates the entire time. Like, it's, I don't know, man, this is peak like Hanson, LA Confidential type writing.
Yeah.
This is really one of the best like thrillers that's out there. And it's really just this kind of cat and mouse between Plummer and Gould, and a great turn from John Candy is in an early role. They work at this bank. It's inside of this mall, which
remember when malls were a thing?
They
were that crowded.
I know.
Right? I remember going like, I was watching it and I'm like, I remember when malls were like that.
All the stores are Canadian, so you couldn't quite like pick out some of like it's not like Fast Times at Ridgemont High.
Right.
Where you can pick out all the stores. But like, I did like that he goes and gets an orange cup.
I wanted an orange Julius at that point. Right. I was like, oh, are there orange Juliuses around? I used to love those things.
That sounds awesome.
Doesn't it?
I really wish that those still existed. And like a baked potato with a bunch of shit on it.
Right. Or like when McDonald's was actually like, you didn't feel too terrible eating it, and you could go sit down in a McDonald's. Yeah. And that's like what you do. Anyway.
So why is this a Christmas movie? It's set during Christmas time. Christopher Plummer is a mall Santa, although that's kind of weird and nebulous too, because he's like, He's like a Salvation Army mall Santa. He's like taking kids on his lap. He's just ringing a bell.
Yeah. Yeah.
And he's written out this sign for you to give to help the less fortunate. But that's clearly all just a grift. He's just taking that money.
And he's just staring at just a minor grift while he's staring at the bank the whole time.
Right. So he's positioned himself to watch the bank and see how it operates. And he goes and it's all kind of like one. What's just so good is that Gould finds the note, finds the note that either was that, you know, was going to be delivered to him or delivered to one of the tellers. And that wasn't that says, I've got a gun. Give me the money. And then he recognizes that the G is written and recognizes that it's on the sign as well.
He must have written it on a separate sheet of paper, but on top of one of the check deposit forms.
Yeah.
Right. And he goes in there and he's like pretending to like write something. But of course, that's carbon paper. And so you can see beneath it, which I'm like, oh, this is such a great sort of like way to find this out. It's also very kind of timely.
Right.
So you can imagine people of a certain age watching this film today and going, what is that?
You know, what's carbon paper?
What's carbon paper? What's a bank? Like, what's
I like that this bank had, it was still stuffy enough to be a bank, right? And like have all of the procedures and what have you. But they also allowed one of their tellers to wear their busty teller to wear a shirt that says bankers do it with interest.
Yes, yeah.
And a penalty for early withdrawal.
Right.
It's like that's a bank that I'd bank at. I mean, I trust my money with that group of people.
And they're all like sleeping with each other.
It's basically
like this incestual
over there. Yeah.
Right. Because Gould asked the Julie out and she's like, oh, I'm actually sleeping with the manager who's married. So I can't.
Right. And the busty teller is
marries John Candy, but sleeping with another guy,
which is a through line. Like you have to think that other guy is potentially
the father
of the baby.
Yes,
that
that's
she's
the whole
have.
Idea.
Right. It's just like, oh, that's not good.
Cause everyone's like looking at him, right? Cause Gould walked in on them in the bathroom at this party. And then the way he's like hovering over her as she's getting married, it's kind of awkward and weird.
We come at this as if Gould is this kind of nebbish, mousy bank teller, but as soon as he sees that that there's a note that, you know, that someone has attempted or at least thought about robbing the bank, he basically takes it upon himself and says, I can do this.
Mm-hmm.
Like, because he doesn't get robbed before he starts to steal money from the bank. He's like, well, I can just present them this note and tell them that I was robbed and I can embezzle. And he already knows that there's a huge amount of money coming through the bank because it's Christmas and people are depositing their money. And so he's got a bunch of money and he's the main bank vault teller. So he's got more money than anybody else at his, his window. And so, you know, by the time, and so as Terrence Stamp is, not Terrence Stamp, as thank you for putting that
you're welcome.
Well, because I was thinking also, like, he puts his money in a Superman, which also is released the same year.
Superman lunchbox.
And so Plummer is casing the joint and watching Gould basically embezzle money from the bank and then goes up and tries to rob him. And then learns that the amount of money that he was able to get out of the bank was smaller based on what they told the television crew, because Gould had actually stolen it himself. And then of course there's this cat and mouse game between Plummer now knowing that he's been screwed over. And now he knows something about Gould, and Gould's this, you know, hero of the moment, and he's been on TV and now he's getting attention from Julie and.
And a bunch of other ladies that come in the bank.
Right. Yeah. They're all want to look at him. And then so they go back and forth. And eventually Gould is able to steal a van and put it and drive it outside of Plummer's home and frame him for stealing the van. And of course, they already wanted him for something else. So he spends some time in jail. And then another woman gets involved with Gould, who was also involved with Plummer.
Right.
We find out that later as they've kind of fallen for each other.
But it's weird because it's also like he knows almost immediately.
Right.
Right.
Yeah.
But just kind of goes along with it because.
Well, I think I think he ultimately sees like he's got to get Plummer out of his life somehow.
Mm-hmm.
Also, you know, Gould is like a lover of fish. He's this kind of nerdy guy who has an aquarium, is always looking for rare fish. I think that Gould is so great in this, and all of his like all of his mannerisms, and the fact that he hides his, you know, the safety deposit box keys and the jam and the chili. Like there's all of these things that should on paper seem contrived, but as they flow through the film, really just kind of like flow.
Makes sense.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah. And then the movie, I mean, like what separates this film from just your normal, like, I don't know, you like the, just your normal everyday thriller is that it, you, like you said, it's sexy. It's ridiculously sexy and ridiculously mean.
I
mean,
oh yeah.
I mean, Plummer basically stomps on a prostitute's head. And
in the sauna,
in a weird like brothel gym. Like, sauna.
I know that was weird. I was like, what is going on here? This is strange.
You just
I know.
Write it off
well, you're right. Well, and then I mean, he decapitates
right.
the woman he sent to, you know, seduce
and leaves her Gould, head in the fish
and leaves
tank.
Her head in the fish tank. I mean, yeah, it is a nasty. But this is the. I mean, so this was 78. When was Blowout?
Oh, around 76.
I mean, a little before, yes, right?
Yeah, yeah.
But I mean, that's another one that's yeah. sexy and mean, right? I mean, that does not end, I mean, really well right. for anybody, right? And right. then, I mean, a film like, you know, Clute, too. Yeah. I mean, I feel like there are these films from that time that were sort of gritty,
well, I mean,
sexy,
yeah.
and then just like really.
And it was time mean. For the grit, too, right? I mean, this yeah. was coming off of like Giallos in Italy, and then American audiences were finally getting mad. Oh, this is a Canadian picture, but. But kind of catching up, those North American audiences were kind of catching back up to like getting films like Death Wish and Dirty right. Harry and things like that as well. So, yeah.
And then we got, you know, Basic Instinct.
Right. Then we did. Yeah. Then we and go Sliver. Into the, like the psychosexual thrillers.
Yeah.
Gould goes up to his apartment to find his new lover. Even though he doesn't really trust her, he finds his new lover beheaded. And he takes her body and dumps it into the foundation of the new bank that's being built. And Plummer's like, man, hats off to you. I would, yeah. I thought I had you up against the barrel. And like,
and this, but this is something else that's really great is that Gould continues to sort of surprise Plummer like every turn. Right. And then there's like this weird begrudging respect too from Plummer. He's like, oh, wow, you're really clever. Okay, that was good, right? And he's always sort of like, all right, I applaud that.
Right.
And Gould kind of looks at him like, you're a jackass, right? Like, I mean, you're a psycho and I'm smarter than you. I'm going to figure this out.
Right.
But I mean, that's a really great twist because again, Gould seems like this mousy kind of like unsure, you know.
I love the fact when Gould kind of laughs at himself. Like after he steals the van, he drives it over to in front of the apartment of Plummer. And then calls the cops and is like, and like it takes on this some voice, about, like this kind of like stereotypical gangster voice, like, hey, you're gonna find him over here. He's yeah. and he's seen him before, and he's be careful. He's got the rod.
Yeah, right.
And then he walks out. He's like, the rod.
The rod. I know. He's just like,
what am I talking about?
What?
You might as well have said paddy wagon. But,
right.
But yeah, it all ends up with, and then it ends up in this great like last kind of confrontation where, they're basically going to he's going to split the money with Plummer and get him off of his back. But Plummer's got to come into the bank because the money's in the bank and they've got to do one more kind of faux robbery. And so Plummer gets in this drag outfit and goes up to Gould and is basically like demanding all the money and more. And Gould finally like just says, hey, he raises his hands and he's got a gun. He's got a gun. He's got a gun.
Because he forged the note. He forged. Yeah.
Right. And there's a big shootout and like with the bank guard shooting into the mall full of crowded people Christmas. Well, not during Christmas anymore, I guess. But yeah. And then this great protracted like death scene for Plummer where he like is like trying to run up a down escalator and can't quite do it because he's running and then he falls down and like
and everyone's like surprised when his like wig and stuff comes off.
Right. And also I guess the other line in this, which is really I think the one kind of weak link in this is Julie's portion in this.
Yeah.
Is like where she's kind of figured out what Gould is mm-hmm. doing and they're and kind of like fallen in love with him because of it. That seems a little, I get that the movie needs a nice crescendo yeah, where Gould yeah. wins And but like a meaner movie in the 70s, it seems like this, like if he was like an L.A. Confidential type of thing, it seems like no one would win. Right.
That right.
Gould would be caught. That Plummer would be dead.
Or
that
or
Julie would walk off with the cash.
Julie would walk off with the money. That's the, yeah. Because, I mean, you know, they kind of circle each other.
Right.
Gould and Julie. And there's, I think Julie is sort of put off by his, indecisiveness, his kind of like wavering sort of sense of being. And then, you know, at the end, she sort of sees him.
Kind of take charge.
Charge and sort of be this kind of, because there's one scene where they go back to his place after the Christmas party at her, you know, at the bank manager's home with his family, who she's having an affair with, which is just weird.
Right. And the bank manager's wife clearly knows that she's having an affair.
So they go back to his place and it's, you know, it looks like they're gonna sleep together. And at one point he's put off by like, you know, Plummer calling, but he also says like, you know what? I've had too much to drink. I don't know. This is a good idea. And she's just like so put off and like pissed off. I'm like, wow. Okay. Really? Like, is this the only time that a woman's going to get upset when a man's like, I'm not sure because we both had too much to drink.
Right.
Right. Actually sort of like enacting and invoking the idea of consent. What the fuck, Julie? I'm just
kidding. Seriously. No, it's 78.
But I know. And that was my own. Like, that didn't exist in 78 apparently. But I mean, yeah, once he finally sort of takes charge and shows himself to be this different kind of person that she always kind of wanted him to be, then it's like, oh, yeah, don't forget your briefcase and I'm coming with you.
Right. Yeah. So, a couple of trivia bits. This was the first film that took advantage of like the Canadian government. Basically, it ended up being kind of a tax shelter thing. But like there were a lot of movies that came after this that were Canadian pictures that were basically funded and filmed in Canada. As a way to like invest in the film industry and give money back to Canada. But it also, a lot of it was, you know, you would get huge tax breaks. And so a lot of films were like a lot of Canuxploitation films were basically created because of this kind of loophole. And this is the first film that was produced or distributed by Carolco. So this Silent Partner and Love Streams are basically
the same production company.
And Superman 4.
Awesome. Yeah, of course. What was the film that Hansen, The Bedroom Window, right?
Yeah.
That Hansen directed with Gutenberg as a leading man in a thriller, in a sexual, in a erotic thriller. That's not really right, but yeah. With Isabelle Huppert.
Yeah.
Anyway.
I forget the actress who plays the love interest, but she was talking to Hansen and was like, I'm fine with nudity as long as it fits the plot. But like, why do I have to be completely naked and Gould doesn't? And he's like, well, you're prettier than he is.
Yes.
So that was the trivia line for
Susanna York was Julie.
It wasn't Julie. It was
what was her name?
Was it Emily?
Was it Elaine?
Elaine.
So Celine Lomez?
Yes. Yeah.
Anything else you want to say about The Silent Partner?
No, watch it. It is a wonderful, wonderful film, and it's one that more people need to see.
Rare exports.
All right.
And what we are exporting, well, it's a different kind of trafficking. I think here. All right, so let me find the in the depths of the Curvaturi Mountains, whatever, 486 meters deep lies the closest ever guarded secret of Christmas. The time has come to dig it up. This Christmas, everyone will believe in Santa Claus. I love the running joke about the Russians in here.
Yeah.
it must be Russians. How are you gonna let the Russians in?
So what do you think?
I love this. It was so much fun. It was so Ebert called this an R-rated Santa Claus origin story crossed with The Thing.
And it's very much The Thing, right? It's very much The Thing.
Yeah, and I think that is a really kind of like succinct, perfect way to put it, because there is this menace that you see in a Carpenter film, but there's also that like weird bit of humor that you also see in like Carpenter films. Yeah. And this plays with that so well, but then also playing on this story that like we all believe, right, or all tell kind of each other that Santa Claus was this thing, and he's He brings presents to good boys and girls. And instead, what he does is actually kidnaps them and eats them.
Right.
If you misbehave or if you're not punished. And then, you know, these fairy tales coming to life and being actually bigger than what we thought. I thought it was a lot of fun.
So the whole premise is this, like, industrial conglomerate, like, is looking for essentially for Santa Claus. Yes. Right. I mean, yeah. and they finally think that they found him. They blow up this portion of and they basically he's encased in ice and they're going through the and so they're going through the process of excavating him from the hole in the ground. And in doing that has awoken, you know,
his elves
that are basically been hiding out for centuries. This film, what it does so well is plays it. There's humor in this, but it plays everything as a straight action film. Like it doesn't ever wink at the audience. And that's what so many of these like types of films do badly. It's like what every. Like a lot of these like Santa sleigh type films. They can be enjoyable, but they're never going to reach that upper echelon of like true cult status or wonderful. I mean, like they're just not going to reach that echelon of like reading a really good movie.
Yeah.
Because it's too much tongue in cheek. There's too much winking at the audience of saying, ha ha ha, this is a whole thing. What this does, like at the very beginning of it, and when it's in English at the beginning, he hands out these, he's like, get these to all of your workers.
Right.
And it's these list of like do's that don't. So basically behavior.
No cussing,
cards.
No.
Yeah. It's basically this whole list of don't be naughty because that's dangerous now. Now that we've unearthed Santa Claus, it's dangerous to be naughty because this is not a lump of coal you're going to get. You're going to die.
You're gonna going die. To yeah, kill he's going you. To take you.
The locals of the area start to notice that the reindeer are right. being killed and that their potato harvests are being stolen and their ovens.
No,
and their,
the sacks.
The sacks, the right. right.
This, only the sacks. Right. It's true. It's true. The potatoes stay, just the sacks.
And their ovens and heaters are being stolen because they want to heat up and unleash, the elves are trying to unleash Santa Claus. Yeah,
but they're putting kids in the sacks.
Right. And there's just so much, they're putting kids in all these naughty kids, and all the kids are obviously naughty.
Except for Pietra.
Yeah. What's so fun about this is, like, there's just, like, the little bits and pieces of it. The elves, like, coming to life when they hear a child or smell a child or when they smell gingerbread or, like, there's all these, right, like, little moments to, you know, the kind of just the lore of it all. And then, you know, it's fun to see, like, in the thing where they start to realize what's actually happening here. I do think this film's held back a little bit by its budget, obviously. I think you spend a good hour, like, with the character buildup. And I do think the one thing that kind of bugs me is the theater role becomes kind of like a John McClane at the end. I would have liked to have seen that character arc kind of like a little less dramatic, right? Because it like he's kind of like a weakling and kind of like always nervous about his dad. Yeah. And like they're all up around these alpha men who are like hunters and like Nordic like gods essentially, right?
Yeah,
I mean, like, right, they just look huge, right?
And even like the one other kid who's close to Pietra's age is already taking on that kind of role, right, of man. I mean, at one point, he walks up to Pietra's dad with like a half, you know, a half smoked cigarette. He's like, "You got a light?" And the guy's like, "Where's your dad?"
Right.
But
yeah. And so Pietra's dad is also a wolf trapper, and that's illegal. But that's how they end up getting one of the elves. One of the elves falls into the wolf trap, and they are able to like they think it's Santa Claus. They think that they've actually found Santa Claus. They're trying to sell him back to the industrial conglomerate.
Right. Cause they blame him for letting like a wolf through the fence that killed all their reindeer,
right?
That they're going to use to sort of, you know, one sell and make it through, it through the winter essentially. And, you know, it was one of the elves that killed all the reindeer, but they still like hold them responsible. So Yeah, they're like, we've got Santa Claus and we want
money,
like, basically. The exact amount of money that the reindeer would have brought us.
Right. And it seems like he's going to pay, and eventually then he just gets puts an axe through the head. And then realizing that it's not Santa Claus and what's actually happening, they decide to, they're basically being... They start to round up all of the, I guess Pietro has the good idea, has the idea of like, well, they're coming to for the kids, right? They're going to feed the kids to Santa Claus.
Yeah.
So all of the elves are going to come to the kids. So they sack up all of the kids and get them in a helicopter.
Yeah.
And try to round up all of the elves, and like they would have done the reindeer, into this pen. And that's when Pietro is like on the sack of kids
with a walkie talkie,
with a walkie talkie, like
hanging on with a walkie talkie, now commanding everybody.
He has the idea of how you put it. And so that like character development happens very, very quickly. He's like, oh, I'm going to take charge of all of this. It would have been a little bit. I guess more believable had it been a Code Noel type of situation where this kid was always kind of mischievous and always kind of like putting together. These Rube Goldberg type.
Yeah. I mean, we see him doing all the research.
Right.
But then like he never quite does anything with that. He doesn't really kind of.
But the bravery to swan dive off of the helicopter into the pen of elves is a little.
Like sacrificing himself. Right. Tell dad,
Right. I would have liked to have also had seen Santa, before blowing him up, like right as he comes out, rather than having him frozen the entire time.
Right. Because we always see is this giant block of ice.
Right.
And we don't see exactly how monstrous he might have been.
It's one of those instances where I would have liked to have seen this movie do well and then them give them money to do a pseudo sequel, kind of like a Robert Rodriguez, like El Mariachi Desperado.
Yeah.
And like give him more money to do something a little bit to take it to the next level.
Evil Dead Part 2.
Right. Exactly.
I mean,
So we could, because again, I do think the budgetary restrictions on this required it to have all of the action be backloaded. Yeah. Not to say that this is a boring film or not enjoyable, but there's just like when you watch it, it is so much fun. And like I said, it plays so straight with the lore and the twist on the tale that it's inevitable that you're going to want more out of it.
Right.
And like it would be so much fun to have this be just a violent, just, bacchanal.
Oh, yeah. Right. Yeah. And I mean, to have that violence happen earlier, right?
Right.
Keep kind of going through there. And that would give you more time to see Pietro do more things or understand more things.
Right.
And the reason he's not like sacked up so fast is because he's like the only good kid left.
Yeah.
I mean, apparently, but then also he's like, I need to be punished, right? Because I did this thing. So like, dad, you have to like hit me. Which I'm not sure, like, why we're getting into, like, corporeal punishment. But at the same time, this is the one sort of self-aware character as well. Like, I know that I did something wrong, and now you have to do this. Or that thing's going to take me away.
Right. Yeah. So, the end of the film, they've blown up Santa. Blown up Santa pretty heavily, by the way. And now they have 185 elves that are captured. So
and that spell is kind of broken on him, right?
Right. So now they're no longer murderous.
They're just like blank slates.
Right. And so they train them to be Santa Clauses and sell them back to different communities.
It's so, and you just see them being locked in crates at the end with like different places stamped on them. And they get like sort of dropped out of. Yeah, that was great. I really did like the exporting of
Santa Claus. Did you ever see the short film?
I didn't. Yeah. I didn't.
The short film, it is more. It assumes that this company, well, not the company, but the people of this land go out and hunt elves and hunt basically Saint Nicholas's. So they do the exact same thing. There's just not this specter of Santa that looms over. Mm. But Santas are these trained Saint Nicholas's that they go out and hunt.
Okay.
And so it's just these naked old men running through the woods and they're shooting them and then training them to become just like that training sequence happens again. So
this did pretty well in its native country. I guess it won the Juicy Award. I'm sure that's J-U-S-S-I. But I don't know how to say it, right? Jussie, Juicy? I like to say Juicy Award.
Well, and the director went on
Best Cinematography.
Yeah, and the director went on to make Big Game, which was not a big hit, but and then this most recent year made Sisu.
Oh, that's the same guy.
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, I didn't realize that. Okay. Yeah.
So, expect more from him, I would imagine. Oh,
that makes sense. I mean, you can see, I think, kind of like the same style and same vision there.
Yeah.
Yeah, fuck Nazis.
But free to watch on Tubi and Pluto and all kinds of platforms. So yeah, check out Rare Exports. Let's do it.
It's fun. You won't be disappointed.
Okay. Such a delayed ta-da. So,
we're going to do the Christmas that almost wasn't.
All right.
How much fun is this movie?
I'm actually glad, because I'm glad to leave Reindeer Games for the last.
Yeah, I know. This is...
give us a rundown on the
plot. I was just going to say, like, Santa has to get a job as a Santa to earn money to pay his overdue rent bill. Basically, Santa has been beset by gentrification and greedy land developers.
Right. He's been used to... North Pole was rent controlled for the longest time.
So, right.
Under new ownership.
We have to explain, because, the summary and every summary of this film makes it sound like Santa is just a deadbeat freeloader, right? But what had happened was, like, the Eskimos had this land, right, in the North Pole, and they made an arrangement with Santa that he could live there forever, right, rent-free. But Phineas T. Prune, right, basically buys whatever he wants. He's like a zillionaire. So he bought the entire North Pole. And he's like, Santa, you owe me back rent. Not even like you owe me rent now. He's like, you owe me back rent.
And not only that, the bills come due. He comes like every single day at dinner time to remind him that he owes back rent.
Where do they live?
I don't.
This is the thing. I'm like, how does Prune get there?
Right. They all get to England, which is essentially where they are in the city, right? I don't know.
I don't know.
But they
all speak a dubbed Italian English anyways.
we're maybe jumping ahead. So we meet at the very beginning. We meet our hero,
Sam Whipple, played by Paul Tripp,
the only person that can play any Sam Whipple in any movie.
Right.
He's lamenting with some town folk and some town children that Christmas can't be every day. Yeah. Why can't Christmas be every day? And I think he posits that the reason that Christmas can't be every day is because we haven't thought of it yet. Basically, well, that it's just we don't have the gumption and we're not stick-to-itiveness that allows us to have Christmas every day.
Why hasn't some like venture capitalist firm like put that forward? Well, or some sort of corporation
that's actually mentioned in Reindeer Games, mm-hmm, by Danny Trejo. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm,
mm-hmm. I know. Christmas too. It would make smart business sense to have another.
So. Later on that evening, Whipple's at his home and he gets a knock on his door and this is about 20, this is a early December, right?
Right.
So it's Santa Claus, because when he was a kid, he wrote Santa and said, "Hey Santa, if you ever need anything, bro,
I'm your guy.
Hit me up."
Right. And
I love all your gifts. I love your work, bro.
I'm a huge fan.
And Whipple's a lawyer.
Right.
And so Santa's
the brokest lawyer in the world.
Right. I need help here because I'm being squeezed. And if we don't do something, like my rent is due on the 24th, if we don't do something, Christmas won't happen. And Whipple's like, well, yeah, sure. We got this.
How much can it be?
Right. Yeah. He's like, oh, and he shows them a piece of paper and we never really realize how much it is. And I think that's smart because it would date the film, right?
Right. Right.
So now it's just a nefarious amount of money.
Yeah.
And Whipple looks in his pocketbook and he's like, "Ah, Santa, I can't cover that. I mean, like, look, I said I would do anything, but I can't cover that.
I'm a lawyer of the people, Santa."
Right. I spend my days decorating town Christmas trees and wondering why there can't be Christmas every single day. Right. How good of a lawyer can I possibly be?
Correct.
But you know what? We'll go to Whipple's house, which happens to be right next door to mine. So I'm going to step out my door and walk outside. Prune's house. Yes, yes, yeah. Prune's house. And we're going to go, we'll go reason with him. Surely, I mean...
He's a reasonable man.
Right? He's a reasonable man. Prune's having none of it. I mean, like, but he's
Prune's
also
not even home.
That's true.
His monster butler
or whatever, and then his dog is there, right? Yeah. So yeah, you're not going to see that was what Santa said too. You're not going to see Whipple. I'll get in to see him.
Like, trust me.
I got this. Yeah, Whipple is the guy who can never deliver on.
Mm-hmm.
So They eventually do see Prune, right? I mean, like, and Prune is like kind of like eating the. Oh no! So they go to the North Pole, right? That's when they go to the North Pole, which seemingly is just down the street.
Right. Well, they are in Santa's magic sled.
I guess that's true. Yeah. Which if
you know, but then just, how does Prune get there?
Yeah. Well, he's a zillionaire, so he's assuming he has some sort of
he has his own magic mode sled
of transportation, just, like, pops right?
In. Yeah.
So Santa's like, look, you're not going to see him, but he comes to my house every single day at dinner time.
Dinner time. He's sadistic.
Which I don't know why Santa didn't say that to begin with, but like, but now like,
he won't be at his house because he's waiting outside of mine. Right. I know where he is.
And like, they go to the North Pole, and Santa's got like 8 elves that help him, and then
Jonathan,
and then one really tall butler himself.
Yeah,
which.
Yeah. The terrible memory.
The sequence where the elves have to go through Jonathan's legs to get out of Santa's house, that was really bothersome to me.
I know.
But anyway, Santa.
The way he pointed.
Right, I know. Pointing between his legs so they could all crawl through.
Waddle through.
So they go, and like Mrs. Claus is making dinner, and of course then Prune shows up, and he's like relishing the fact that Christmas is not going to happen, and that Santa can't pay his rent. So Wibble comes up with a great idea. You just need to get a job. We'll get you a job.
They try to reason with him, right?
Sure.
And I forget, like, what is the thing that, like, Prune says, like, okay, he says, I won't charge you rent ever, but here's the thing, like, you can never give another toy to a child.
Right. Basically, right? Yeah.
You got to quit being Santa Claus. Christmas. You can stay here, but you got to quit being Santa Claus, right? And then, I also love, because I don't want to move too far beyond this, but I love how Prune hates any kind of compliment or like, you know, I mean, Mrs. Claus is like saying very nice things. And he's like, I kindly request you keep your kindness to yourself, madam. Right? It's just like this great thing. I will hold you responsible if I don't sleep well tonight because you were nice to me.
The other disturbing thing about Santa's environment is that he very Mike Pence-esque, he calls his wife mother.
Yeah.
They don't have any kids.
They don't have any kids, mind
you. So there's no reason for him to call her mother.
Right.
Yeah, it's very creepy.
Yeah. But then Whipple says, I know, we'll get a job.
We'll get a job. And so they go work at a Macy's knockoff, and Santa Claus becomes the first department store Santa. It never happened before.
Whipple had a brilliant idea.
It really was a good idea. Yeah, it really was a banger of an idea. And Santa's freaked out because he's evidently never seen a kid awake.
He only likes sleeping children, which not creepy at all.
No, not at all.
I mean, it's never been creepy whenever anyone has said, I like to watch you sleep. That has only ever been said with just like pure innocent love. What are you doing? Watching you sleep? Get the fuck out.
But Santa is like over, like nervous to the point where he's going to see a live kid, a kid who is awake. But he gets the job, and then Whipple is a janitor of some sort at this door.
He straightens things up.
And then the night before, him and Santa decide to play with all the toys. The creepiest ass 1970s to 60s toys you'd ever seen.
Yeah.
Like a really bizarre colored stuffed chicken, and like it's all just all over the place. But they play with all of them, and then like then when the kids come to the store the next day, the mom's like, I wouldn't expect this kind of behavior at this store where Santa and
adults playing with toys.
And then they picked them up in real short order. It really is like a few seconds. And it's like, and then it's fine. And then the kids and
everyone
wildly excited about it.
Love like, Santa.
You're dressing them down for playing with the toys. And then as a minor inconvenience, this is a 1966 Karen that's like weirdly misplaced anger. And then the kids are crazy about it, right? And like no one questions the fact that Santa knows all the kids' names without them actually telling them what they want for Christmas.
Right.
And this goes.
My favorite line from that moment where the first little girl is like tugging on Santa's beard, and her mother's like, "Don't pull on like this, you know, like fake beard or whatever." And she's like, "No, mom, it's real." And she pulls it. She's like, imagine that, Mr. Prim finding an old man with a real beard. Because like, real beards don't exist.
Yeah, it didn't. Yeah, not 1960s England. It was very, very passe to have an old man and
be an old man and to be have bearded, a beard.
Right. Yeah. Prune's having none of this. He tries to thwart the plan weirdly at Every turn, he is doing something. He's spitting spit wads at balloons. He's putting itching powder on kids. And then eventually gets it on himself. None of this actually works. So Prune decides to do what zillionaires do, and he buys the department store.
The fucking place.
And he also then breaks his own merchandise and then makes Santa pay for that merchandise so that Santa won't have enough money to pay his rent.
And again, Whipple's not a good lawyer. Because this is clear what happened, and there is no...
There were witnesses to Prune breaking his own...
There was actually a kid that looked at Prune and shook his finger and was like, get out of here. I mean, so he was caught by the kids. Yeah, but Whipple just being like, oh, gosh darn it, there's no legal recourse here.
And Santa just basically pays without even questioning it.
I know.
Questioning
I know.
The cost of any of it. He's like, well, that's going to be a giraffe, and that's two, and this is this thing, and that's four, and that's going to leave you with one. I'm like, wait a minute. We didn't ring this up or anything. These
just in your head. And I love how he says, it's in the new bylaws that I just wrote.
Right, which are not legally binding to the past. Which
at all.
But anyway, Whipple foils the day again. And then this is Christmas Eve. We don't know what we're going to do.
Right. Except buy really cheap Christmas trees.
Right. So we go to a Christmas tree lot, and there's this kid there who's selling the cheapest Christmas trees.
He just bought his.
He just bought his and said, hey, the cheapest trees you can, the cheapest trees you can get are the day before Christmas. So go buy your tree. And then the kid's like, you know what? It's like, how does a kid find out that Santa's in dire straits?
Cause he walks by right with the tree, and he's like, yo, cheap trees over there. Right. And then he stops and he's like, you look familiar. Do I know you? Right.
Do you watch me when I sleep?
Have you copped on this corner before? Right? And he's like, you're Santa Claus. And Santa Claus is like,
hold the shit.
You got me right. Right. You motherfucker, what?
Yo, you bringing my shit tomorrow, bro?
And Santa Claus is like, this is America. I got to, right?
Right.
So then the kid's like, what's wrong, Santa? You look sad. What's going on? And Santa's like, oh, I can't tell you, little Charlie, whatever. Right. I think his name was Charlie.
And yeah, and he was like, you know what? You've helped me out so many times, Santa. Let me help you. Tell me what your problems are.
Right. Yeah.
I got you. Again, just like Whipple.
And I love this kid. He's so mature. He's like, no. We got it. We'll figure it out, man. Whatever it is.
There's no problem too big for the two of us, right?
We can do it. And he puts the tree down.
So Santa tells him his woes.
He doesn't. He won't tell him, right? He goes over to Whipple and he's like, what's the deal?
What's the deal with your boy?
Right? He's like, come on. You look, I know something's going on. Just tell me. And Whipple just whispers it in his ear. And he's like, and the kid is just kind of like, would a quarter help? No, that's not going to do it. I know, Santa. We'll wake up all the kids. You've helped us. They'll help. They won't even ask. They'll just give you what they have. It's fine. Don't worry about it. And sure enough.
And then, wait. Then he starts to yell.
Wait, kids!
In the city. And he walks like he's in a Broadway production. He steps, he's got his hands on his hips.
It's like a Kimbo. Right?
Yeah, he's very swinging his hips around in a very, I don't know.
It's too bad no one saw us just doing that. I know it's an audio medium, but you have to imagine the two of us, and he's like, chairs on wheels.
But he goes and yells in one location, and then all these kids start bringing Santa their spare change in just piggy banks. You can't imagine that Prune is one going to take this money. He's got however much
money. It's currency. You're legally required to take it. If it's legal tender, you have to take it.
A month's worth of salary for Santa.
I can walk in with a sack of pennies. You still have to take it.
And Santa takes this money. And then they figure out, they find, so all this time, Santa's like, look, Prune, because Prune at one point denies ever being a kid.
Right.
This is the whole thing. It's like, you had to have been a kid once. You had to love Santa one time. It's like, I was never a kid. And so Santa.
He's deathly afraid of kids too.
Right. Santa sets his bookkeeper to look for the letter that Prune must have sent. And they have his real name and they're looking it up. And I'm thinking.
Apricot?
Yes.
Oh,
yes.
Prune.
Yeah.
Plum. Plum.
Prune. And so, if, you know, last minute, they find it and rush it down to Santa.
But we don't know that.
That's true.
Right?
That's true. Now we're getting because, all the coins, and
yeah,
that's basically it.
Yeah, we pay Prune, like, drop these two bags of pennies. Right.
Right.
And Prune is so distraught. I love, like, Mrs. Claus, mother, is like, it's okay. You tried.
You tried to ruin Christmas.
Like, she just loves. She's like, no, I'm so sorry you're feeling this way. Jonathan is like, oh, wait, right, don't forget, I have something for you. And they're like, throw it in the sleigh, Jonathan. And he does. And then that's it.
Right.
Yeah. And then so they go off in a montage to deliver presents.
But the thing is that I guess Mr. Prune's letter had gotten lost and never got to Santa.
Well, look, Prune sent a postcard.
Sure. It should have worked. I mean.
Right. But look, Jonathan does not seem like the most organized bookkeeper around. And that postcard fell behind his desk.
Right.
And he finally found it. And then he wrote a note to Prune apologizing, right? I hope you can forgive Santa. I will never forgive myself.
Which is pretty touching.
I mean, it really is.
And right? So Santa gives Prune the gift that he always wanted.
Which is
a schooner. Goddamn schooner. And then
schooner Prune, is a sailboat.
Prune has a psychotic break. And goes outside and screams in the face of all the locals about how he can't believe that he's wasted, you know, however many years of Christmas. Yeah. And so everyone looks at him with a weird side eye. And then they go on.
And then it's a Christmas carol.
And, right. And then they do this really, really bizarre, like good 3 to 4 minute montage of just still photos of Santa standing around with Whipple and Mrs. Claus. Uh-huh. On rooftops, mm-hmm. and chimneys, mm-hmm. and like some of the pictures are not in focus.
Oh no. They're like double exposed.
Some of them are like just like with weird, like some of them, like it's where like Whipple and Santa are angry at one another, and it is the most bizarre sequence to wrap up a film.
This whole film is bizarre.
Of course. Yeah, we're playing like it's straight. This is deep in live action 1960s. Like, this is Kate Gordon shit. This is the craziest
movie.
This
is a bug nuts fucking movie.
And it's not necessarily all that short either. Like, it's not overly long.
You know, it's like an hour 35 or
right,
something, right?
But it's also a musical, so there's musical numbers interspersed through this, which we really haven't even touched on. I said the title song, The Christmas That Almost Wasn't, actually is a pretty banger.
I love that song. I have sung it every year at Christmas time.
Every day is Christmas. That song sucks.
Yeah.
But the Christmas That Almost Wasn't is actually a pretty good song.
It's such a good song. Right. And I love how they like stretch certain words to fit the, you know, the rhyme scheme and the rhythm of it. So
yeah,
it's
yeah,
just like,
yeah.
Well, that boy, I don't think Mary is actually that
word. A couple things. There was when they're lined up to go see Santa for the first time, they go through the whole progression of kids. One of the kids has a very distinct black eye. It's never explained. I was like, I don't know what the fuck's going on, but that's creepy.
I love
this
it.
This kid's just got a okay. random ass black eye.
But this movie is so dark.
Oh yeah.
And I just mean like,
yeah, no, it's
everything's dark and gray and everybody's like skin tone is dark and gray. It's like,
yeah, this looks like they're all chimney sweeps from like yeah. Mary Poppins-esque in England, right?
Yeah. Yeah. Oh yeah. Yeah. I mean, Santa just looks like he's pulled an all-nighter, just right. gone on a bender and his eyes are just so droopy and black.
The elves are horrifying as well.
Jonathan's creepy looking.
Yeah,
I mean,
yeah,
he looks like the kind of man who would hang around with elves all day. Right?
It's one of those like there were a lot of like films like this that get produced as kind of like cheapy, you know, kiddie productions that yeah. that exist. And so if you can go down this rabbit hole of like all of them, like Santa Claus, Gone Christmas, hello. Santa Claus referred to her.
I think I've seen that one.
Right. Santa Claus Conquers the Martians. There's a Mexican one called Santa Claus. There's one called Santa Claus and the Ice Cream Bunny.
Yeah, right.
Which
right.
is fucking terrible. you try to sit through that one.
I was going to suggest that one, and I'm glad that I didn't, right? Because, yeah.
I've seen it a couple times.
I know.
I made my kids watch it. It's like, and it was played at AGFA one year. It's funny because in the 35 millimeter version of it, there's a whole sequence in the middle that's like Jack and the Beanstalk or another fairy tale. One of them's Jack and the Beanstalk, and one of them's something else. But like, if you get the 35mm version, it's Jack and the Beanstalk. And if you watch the one that's online, and they're all free because they're all public domain at this point. Right. The other one that's kind of fun is The Magic Christmas Tree, which is also shit. I mean, they're all terrible.
Right,
but I think, again, we were talking about this last night, but like this one, I think it gets undeserved hate.
Oh, yeah.
Like it's a 3.5 or something on IMDb. Look, it's not good, but it's not like, it's not unwatchable.
No.
And I would imagine if you had a group of friends and watched this, this would be a lot of fun to watch.
Oh, together. Yeah. Yeah. You can just imagine sort of the comments that you're making, the whole thing. Right.
Because there's a level of creepiness that exists through all of this. And it exists through all of these, like, I mean, look, the whole.
Do you mean through Christmas?
Kids, if you're home, turn this off. But if you're the whole idea of like this idea that Santa like watches you when you sleep, knows when you're sleeping, and knows when you're awake.
Well, it makes sense that then Santa would actually eat kids.
right. So all of, especially 60s stuff, all had like a level of just generic like unease and creepiness to it. And like they didn't really know how to take that staginess that a lot of these productions had and then kind of tone it down for film. And again, you're doing it such on the cheap that a still picture montage to end your movie. It made sense, right? I mean, and like again, badly taken pictures at that point,
like horrible, like really bad. And add in the like weird dubbing of sound and the fact that I feel like half of them spoke Italian originally and then were dubbed in English, but then like Whipple spoke English, but the sound was off on that too.
Right.
So it's just none of it like works because this was directed by Prune.
Oh, that's Prune?
Uh-huh.
Okay.
Prune is Rossano Brazzi.
So he only did three other movies, or two other movies. I knew, but he acted in a bunch of stuff. Yeah. So I did not recognize him as being Prune, which is fun. I guess
that's fun. And Tripp came up with the story, and then I think gets credit as the writer too. I guess Tripp did a bunch of kid stuff like this. He did the story of Tubby the Tuba.
Okay.
Who's like, I mean, right, like in 42 or something or 45, right. I don't know, but did a bunch of stuff like that. And,
again, this, for a cheapo holiday film, there's worse things you can do. Oh, this is not Rankin and Bass, right? But I mean, but I would say that one, it's I think we probably have to grade Christmas movies on a scale, and especially for kids, especially the ones that were pre 1980 or even then. They've all kind of had levels of badness to them. But like, I don't know, this seems like this is just in line with all the rest of them. And like, it's and as far as like entertainment goes and like plot and story, this is heads and tails above things like Santa Claus Conquers the Martians. Right. What the fuck? I can't. Or the ice cream.
Just do the ice cream bunny.
The ice cream bunny or the magic Christmas tree. I mean, you know, so, I think I've said enough about this movie.
Yeah, no, it's. I mean, this was one that I watched as a kid because I think my mother watched it, you know, when she was of a certain age, and so she, you know, she passed that on to me. So I blame her for my kind of talking about. I talk about this film every year to just anybody who will listen, and I sing that stupid song, but I love that song. I'll plug it into this episode somewhere.
Yeah, I think just last thoughts. I wondered if Santa and Prune returned the money to the kids at that point,
that's Prune a good question. Just kept
it. And then, like, for all of Prune's like bad habits and evilness, he really kind of comes out unscathed. I mean, like I said, he has a kind of an emotional break, but like outside of that, really, and that was the thing. Like, I think Prune's reaction was an overreaction to not getting the schooner. As a kid to like try to ruin it for everyone and then to spend what you could estimate as untold millions on a department store that was successful during the height of Christmas.
It's not going to be
and then land in this. He turned out successful in spite of not getting a schooner. I think there's more than just an apology that's owed to Santa and Mrs. Claus and to Mother.
I think this film has a dark underbelly of capitalism written all over it, Jason.
Right. And I think that may be what Prune was trying to tell us all along. That Santa is a little too socialistic in
just giving things away
in a capitalist. Well, not only that, I think that you know, in a society, in a late stage capitalistic society that we live in now, we shouldn't be asking, like, Santa should be turning around and saying, hey, look, your mom and dad should work harder for the things that you want and put in more hours and then be able to buy them. Because Santa's, you know, that's what Santa does, is he's more of a Christmas influencer at this point.
Yes.
And like, is keeping that alive.
He's
doing
it for the gram.
He's doing it for the gram.
He's got paid partnerships to work through. And also, like, if we're all special enough to get presents, then is anybody really special enough to get presents?
That's a good point.
Yeah.
And I think they would think that we can, that's probably a good point to end on.
Yeah, good. Let's talk about, speaking of special, let's talk about reindeer games.
No, fuck that. Nick doesn't do anything until Nick gets something for Nick. You got it? I want some hot chocolate. You want to hear about some job of mine? I want to see some goddamn hot chocolate. And some pecan fucking pie.
All right. So after assuming his dead cellmate's identity to get with the other man's girlfriend, an ex-convict finds himself a reluctant participant in a casino heist. The Tomahawk. can I just say this, Riffus? What the fuck is this movie?
Yeah.
This should have been good, right?
It should have been good.
It's got Gary Sinise, Charlize Theron, Ben Affleck, Danny Trejo, Donald Logue, right? As a kind of stewish character, whatever, if you get that reference. I know you do. Right? Clarence Williams III.
Who's great,
right? Directed by Frankenheimer. Like, why wasn't this Ronin in the Michigan UP?
Yeah, I mean, I don't. Well, and so there's, like I said, there's two versions of this. One is 2 hours and 4 minutes long, and then there's one that's an hour and 45 minutes long. What's crazy to me is that, one, it tests poorly, right? And so they go out and they cut a bunch of stuff. But that's the thing, though. And so they cut a few things, and then the studio kind of really weirdly, like, butchers it. Not that the director's cut is great.
Right.
But, like, it's so, like, normally you would see, like, big chunks, right? Like, if I told you 20 minutes was cut out of this movie, you're thinking, okay, well, then there's a whole sequence that we don't get anymore.
Yeah.
This is Reindeer Game Redux, right? I mean, like, there's something that they pulled out. And all they really did is they just chopped it to speed up. They cut out character development.
So they trimmed some stuff.
That's at a lot of different points. Yeah. They trimmed some stuff, and then they were like, well, let's get to the action. And this really wasn't this was a heist movie. This was not really an action film. And like, really, the only action that occurs is they try to ramp up like some of the car chases
and the chases. Yeah.
But the only action that really occurs is the shootout at the casino, right? And so this kind of crescendos into a pseudo Reservoir Dogs kind of like a violent ending. But it really wasn't that the entire time. And it feels like all of the actors are game. I mean, like,
right.
Affleck is absolutely the wrong choice here. Yes. And I think that if you do it with somebody else who can play it with a little bit more nuance and can play those emotional, like, here's the thing. I don't ever believe that Affleck is, especially in the non-director cut version, in the theatrical version, I don't ever believe that Affleck is scheming enough or smart enough or conniving enough to be able to pull one over on any of these guys. Mm-mm. And so that does come through a little bit better. Like, you know how you have the disjointed voiceover? Like,
yeah.
There's a mid-movie voiceover, and then there's an end voiceover.
Well, and there's a beginning.
Yeah.
Let me tell you how I got here.
Right. Yeah, yeah. There's more of a voiceover. There's more of an inner monologue that goes through in the director's cut. Right. Outside of that, it's just bits and pieces.
But do you think voiceovers work that often?
No, I think people see too much Scorsese and think that it's something that's necessary. No, this did not.
Yeah.
Look, there wasn't anything that was going on in Ben Affleck's head that we needed to know about, right?
I mean, right.
And like, so, yeah, the voiceover here was, and especially because, you know, you don't get it for so long in the theatrical
cut. And then it pops up again.
And you're like, when he's in the truck and he's like, okay, we get it. We get what he's like, where he's at. And like, it's just a matter of like, what the fuck are you trying to tell
me? It's not that complicated either.
Right. I mean, and yeah, exactly. This plot is by the fucking numbers, right?
And it's like it tries to throw a couple twists in there and you're like, oh gosh, never would have thought that.
Yeah.
So, none of them are that like
shocking,
that reveals her.
This movie. Look, you're absolutely right. This movie should be fun because here is the basic premise, is that Santa Claus was manipulating Rudolph the entire time.
That's true. Yes.
And so that is a great fucking mean point.
Yeah.
Is that Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer was not the story we were told. Well, the story that we actually, there actually was, is that Santa Claus saw this outcast reindeer and said, look, and then realized and probably made sure that all of the other reindeers laughed and called him names. Mm-hmm. And then because when Santa needed him on a suicide mission on a foggy night to guide his sleigh during then he manipulated Rudolph into joining the sleigh on a night that they probably wouldn't have made it anyway.
Right.
And so Rudolph is this fucking, he's this sacrificial lamb.
Who that just happened to make it through.
That is a cool
that is,
twist on this story.
Yep. And so his cellmate's name is Nick.
Right.
And his name is Rudy.
You ever listen to How Did This Get Made? That podcast with They do this, and then when Jason Mantzoukas realizes that Rudy is Rudolph, he fucking loses his mind. And I love Jason Mantzoukas; he's so great. He's but yeah, he's just like his head
just almost explodes.
Yeah,
I'm gonna have to go back and listen to that. That's great.
But yes, this movie should be so much more fun, even with the meanness and the violence, like. So evidently the dart scene didn't test all that well. Like they were like worried about people were turned off by the violence of it or the cruelty of it. Although I think it was really like when you watch it the next time, he gets like four more darts stuck in him. And then you see him pull his shirt off and like try to like heal himself a little bit. I'm being like braggadocious here, but. Can't imagine, like he'd just fallen in a lake of an ice lake. He wouldn't be feeling the darts that go into his chest anyway.
And
this wouldn't be that painful.
I was gonna say, I mean,
weird scene. Like if they had hit him in the face, which I understand you're not gonna do that, but if they had hit him in the face where like the first time where they're trying to aim for him, that's one thing. But just in the chest, like the fatty part of your chest,
Sure, it's gonna hurt. Sure. But
it's not like screaming hurt.
Well, and then to look like he's half dead after that was the thing. I'm like, why is he? Because I thought that too. I'm like, why is he so like, oh my god, he's like shaking on the bed. And
like he's lost blood.
Like two darts. I know.
Yeah,
that was weird.
Yeah, but like that's the problem. I think the problem with this film is that it all lies on Affleck's shoulders, and Affleck can't pull this off.
Like we were talking about earlier.
You know, had you taken Nick and switched, you know, him into that role, I don't think you need a huge name for this movie. But you could have gone with a more of a tried and true action star. This movie just has weirdness all over it. Like it just doesn't it's shot oddly. Like there's a lot of like really close-up angles and
like those weird like Dutch angles does Frankenheimer did he do that in Ronin a little bit, not I'm trying to think of but it's almost like De Palma angles
and then like the sex scene between Theron and Affleck was almost like it wasn't I read about it it was because it's so weirdly shot like there's a sequence where like you're seeing like they're pulling apologies, but Affleck's pulling Charlize Theron's pants off, and like you're getting this weird, like awkward shot of her butt, like for a long take. Like this is not a sexy scene at all.
No,
and then you just but so what Frankenheimer did was like they didn't script it; they just let Affleck and Theron do what they do, and they had two cameramen in the room, and they said just follow them around, just follow them. Which one? Why?
Yeah,
like. And I know this is 2000. This is not today where we have, you know, people on set to make sure everyone's comfortable. And I'm not saying that Charlize was uncomfortable in this or anything.
Seems like a weird way to film that.
Why wouldn't you just, okay, all right, we're going to move to this shot. We're going to move to this shot of you kissing this and that and the other. Right. And we're going to do this very methodically. And because now there's like these weird sequences of now they've got to improvise a sex scene together, but not actually having sex. And it's just this weird like. Now, like especially for Theron in that particular role, like maybe she talked about it with Ben beforehand. But I mean, if you've got to like figure out, okay, now I'm going to go do this, and like it just seems weird that the main director wouldn't have said, okay, here's what we want out of this scene. We want a couple of up tops and we want a couple of down bottoms and we want a couple of thrusts here and a handhold here and a lick there. And then we're done. And then we're good. We got our shots, right? I mean, like, make it as recipe'd as, you know, and as unsexy as you possibly can to get the sexy scenes out of the way. It also seems like a weird time. like Theron seems like in this part in her career, this is what's been given to her, mm-hmm, right? Mm-hmm. She has been given these roles of where she will disrobe and show a lot and being kind of uncomfortable. She does the same thing in The Devil's Advocate. And there's a couple other movies where she's just kind of there for, and she's actually pretty good in this. Mm-hmm. Like, I mean, she can carry the weight of being a manipulative girlfriend, but also, you know, appearing like you don't really know her, her intentions the entire time. And I think Sinise is a lot of fun in this. I think Clarence Williams is awesome. Clarence Williams is having a great time in this movie.
He has a great time in everything he's in.
Yeah.
I mean,
I don't think Trejo is enjoying himself. I don't think that, Stubblefield actually knows that he's in a movie. And I don't think that Donald Logue is really like, I think you know who's in that role before Donald Logue?
Vin Diesel.
Vinny D, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, Vin Diesel, but they were like creative differences.
Right. Well, at that point.
Look, there wasn't enough emphasis on family.
At that point, Diesel would have been a legit star. Like, he'd already been in Pitch Black. He would have already been, like, so this would have been, like, right at the cusp of, like, him being.
Because then, like, Fast and the Furious is coming soon. Yeah.
So, I mean, like, it's weird for, and like, he would have already done Save Your Private Ryan. So, I mean, like, at this point.
When did Fast and the Furious come out? Because this was 2000. Would he have?
I don't.
It was right around there. Anyway.
Yeah. Go. Well, maybe I could be wrong. I thought Pitch Black was 99, but I could be wrong about that. But either way, this is right at the beginning of it. And this would have been something like where, like, Vin Diesel tells.
Pitch Black was 2000. Sorry.
Okay. So Vin Diesel tells Spielberg that he's not, you know, taking his shirt off or taking, you know, because he only shows his arms in Vin Diesel movies for that, you know?
Right,
so like at this point, like he's got a big enough head where I can't imagine you putting him in that role and not putting him in the Gary Sinise part and not the Donald Logue part. The Donald Logue part is such a non-part.
He's like barely in it.
Right. I mean, yeah. And maybe his part was beefed up, but I mean, even it beefed up, how beefed up could you're still a fourth bill.
What does he have? Like three lines of dialogue?
Yeah.
I mean,
yeah,
really, yeah. It's.
And I mean, really, probably a fifth bill after you talk about Dennis Farina. I mean, so like.
I love Dennis Farina.
Farina's great. See, that's the
thing.
He's
so good.
He's having a ball in this movie, too. So, yes, this should be a lot better of a movie.
Yeah.
And it's just, I don't know why it falls so flat, other than like when you just don't believe Affleck.
Yeah.
And like, because I mean, like when you opened the podcast with, I want some fucking hot chocolate and some goddamn pecan pie. Affleck has so many moments like that in his career where he can't deliver a line without talking like that. There's especially in like Kevin Smith movies where one of them, like where he's like, why can't it be my time, Lord, kind of thing when he's talking about Jay and Silent Bob. And like, there's just so many of those that if you don't rein him in, and you don't retake that to tell him to do it a different way, that's how he's going to do it every single time. Yeah. There's so many moments like that that just suck, and they just suck you right out of the movie. And then again, you're supposed to believe all of these things that he is and that he isn't. And again, the reveals come walking down Main Street, right? I mean, like you know that he's being set up from the jump.
Oh yeah.
I mean, you know that there's going to be a double cross down the road. It's just
at least one. I mean,
right. Yeah, it's just not as much fun. It's also, it has the weird Ashton Kutcher cameo in it. He's the kid who puts on the coat.
Oh my God, really?
Yeah.
Oh, I didn't catch that. No wonder I was so happy when they beat him up.
In the director's cut, you see him in the casino, like Affleck clocks him and then watches him walk into the bathroom.
Right.
And then
wait, is that not in the theatrical? So no. Then I did watch the director's cut.
Okay.
Maybe I still fucking hate this movie.
It's not good. But yeah, this, I don't know what to compare it to or what it should be like, but it's, you're given all of these juicy character actors who are game for the role. They're playing it to the rafters, but each time you're centering your movie around, like, this is like Paycheck to me. Like, and actually Paycheck actually works a little bit better than this, because Affleck's not quite, he still kind of plays that boob the entire time, where he's like kind of trying to figure stuff out. But there's these action films that like he just can't quite pull off, and it's, yeah, you, every time you come back to him, you're wanting, well, shit, I want to go someplace else.
Right. When it's like, I mean, you know, in these films, he has that smirk on his face the entire time, which you're going, okay, you have to know what's, you're really not sort of selling this kind of, you know, boob role, or
right.
That you're not in on the joke, right, with us the whole time.
Right. You need someone. I mean, like I said, yeah, you need to take him out of the role altogether. Yeah. Because if you, like, you've even put like Sinise in this role, like, I mean, like, he would have been able to pull it off. I mean, Donald Logue would have been able to, would have been great in that particular position. But you're trying to put it around a star, at least at the time. And then,
But I mean, a movie like The Town, and I said this before, right? But a movie like The Town, where he is at the middle of it, right? He's nominally the star of the movie, but he kind of gets out of the way.
Right.
Right.
Yeah.
He just, his face is blank the entire time. Right. Great. But like Renner gets to act, and John Hamm gets to do John Hamm things. And, you know, like I said, Blake Lively does what she does, but I mean, even, you know, Rebecca Hall is in there and doing better work, but you know, yeah, that's a moment where he just, I mean, he has his thing.
Well, and I'm not even going to say that he's not good in dramatic roles. This is asking him to do too much of the load lifting, and he's just not up for the task. One of the things that stood out to me was like his big rig driving, as tough as Gary Sinise makes it out, and that's like driving a million miles, and he goes, he's got to drive 1,000 more by sundown. If we don't do it, the crew don't eat by sun up. I'm like, is it really, I'm like
sure that that's how that like right
is works. It, is like, it that hard of a job?
Well, I don't know. I guess I don't know many big rig drivers who have a crew with them.
Right. I didn't really understand that either.
I know.
Like none of that. This is all very Cassavetes-esque. None of that's ever really explained well, like what these guys actually do.
The difference is, I feel like in a lot of Cassavetes stuff, you're okay letting that go. Right. You're like, you know what? There's enough other stuff going on or that I understand that that's fine. Right. Where this, you're like, wait, this is actually kind of like integral to the plot. So like maybe you should.
Right. A lot of these people took this job to work with
Frankenheimer,
right? Which is the only way to explain the cameos. Like Isaac Hayes is in this in a bizarre role at the beginning. I don't know why they picked Stubblefield other than he's just a gigantic human being. I mean, like, the Michael Clark Duncan hadn't hit yet. So like, so there wasn't that, you know, Hulk that existed. Then Ashton Kutcher would have been in that 70s show for 2 years at this point.
Right. Yeah.
Like
he's
does Dude, Where's My Car this exact same year. So he's enough of a recognizable name not to just like be a, I'm going to pee myself in the bathroom kind of guy. and so let me ask you this. There's a distinct, like in your version, does Love Roller Coaster play over the casino heist? Because that's the way to know if it's the theatrical version or the non-theatrical version. Because Love Roller Coaster gets cut in the director's cut.
Oh.
He must have watched the director's cut.
Okay. Yeah.
Okay. Well, there's another version too. Like did you see Affleck get hit with 4 darts in his back?
No.
Okay. Then you watched the theatrical.
Okay.
Cut. So
weird though. They're like, okay. No, he got hit like in the chest and the arm.
Right.
That was what I.
Yeah.
So I like fast forwarded.
It could have been
just
that,
like, oh my God,
just fell asleep.
I just like am done with this film. I love that, like, Charlize Theron, I think this was in 2007, said, "This is the worst film I've ever done, but I wanted to work with Frank. Like, I wanted to work with Frankenheimer."
Right. Is that true? Is this the worst film that she's ever done?
I don't know. That's what she said.
I mean, yeah, I don't want to discount her thoughts and feelings on this.
She was in The Astronaut's Wife.
Yeah.
And Mighty Joe Young.
Ooh.
Ooh, and Celebrity.
Celebrity, but Celebrity, she would have just been a cameo at that point.
Yeah.
I think she was
a model.
Like, yeah.
She was in, you know, 2 Days in the Valley and The Devil's Advocate before Celebrity. So, I mean, she still would have been just like a cameo in Celebrity, but she was bigger than that.
But that was, but Celebrity, no, but that's, so Celebrity was all about cameos.
No.
I mean, so like DiCaprio's in Celebrity. And
no,
like,
I know. I understand.
I mean, I know she's
but
a
you
star.
Were sort of like dismissing her
No, I just dismissed her role in it because I knew that's what it would have been, a small, like, she wasn't a
But main she was part. Still in it.
Right, right.
And it's still a shitty film.
Yes, it is.
That was my only...
I'm not sure what we're arguing
about. That was my only point. I know. God.
Right. I guess, okay. My point...
Let it go, Weiser.
My point is that it's okay to be in a shitty movie if you're only in it for a few minutes. Oh,
okay. Right, see, so, that's not what I was...
Like, I wouldn't consider Celebrity as Charlize Theron.
I understand. So. Like, she's like, well, she's not really in it.
Right.
Like, so this has to be like a Charlize Theron vehicle?
Or at least she has to be in the top 10 bill. Like, okay. I don't consider Reindeer Games an Ashton Kutcher or an Isaac Hayes vehicle. Like, that's not, like, if you're telling me the worst movie that Kutcher's been in, it's not Reindeer Games, because that's not really his film.
Okay. Fucking fair enough, right? She would do The Yards right after this.
Yeah, good.
You know what? Nice, like, look, you need to leave James Gray alone.
Well, he's left us all alone, so it's fine.
Look,
I might be able to revisit those and come around. I don't know.
Listeners,
they are all solid 6.5s.
Oh my god!
Like, if I'm beautiful girling,
no, that was 7.5.
I know, but these are all good solid 6.5s.
Sounds nice.
That's it.
All right. Anything else you want to say about these films or Reindeer Games or,
no,
any parting shots at my love of James Gray?
Watch The Silent Partner.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
It's a good.
Watch Rare
Exports. Watch The Christmas That Almost Went. You got kids? Watch The Christmas That Almost Went. I guarantee kids will like this movie.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
They may be bored by it. I don't know. The 2023 kids may be bored by
it. You stopped yourself from saying kids these days.
Kids these days might be bored by it.
These days. I don't know. Well, yeah, I mean, for part two of our extravaganza, we'll be back shortly to exchange gifts. And I think we might try to squeeze in one Harley film. I don't know. We'll see if we have time. I don't want to make any promises and ruin your Christmas.
I don't want to give Hartley a short
shrift. Yeah, either. I don't either. That's true. So you know what? Never mind. We're just going to stick with the Christmas presents.
I know that everyone's on pins and needles waiting for us to get back to Hal Hartley. But I actually am. But I
so want to talk Surviving Desire.
Did you find a place to see it?
It's on Criterion.
Okay, cool. Yeah. So
it's on, because like everything of his is on Criterion right now.
Oh, nice.
So I don't know how long it'll stay there, but I really want to talk about that one. And the like weird dance. And Simple Man is so fucking, anyway.
You're getting ahead of yourself.
I know.
You got those, the last skeleton of Kadavra?
You're right. And A Reason to Believe. And look, we'll talk two French feel good movies.
Mine are decidedly not that. This will be fun.
So Merry Christmas. Until then, you have something to look forward to, and thanks for listening.
Keep on screaming.
Was a Christmas that almost wasn't, because of a man named Prune. Now Prune was a man who jolly wasn't, sweet wasn't.
You have been listening to Why Does the Wilhelm Scream with your hosts, Brock and Jason. If you like today's episode, do us a favor and rate, review, and subscribe in whatever application you use to consume podcasts these days. You can reach us by visiting whydoesthewilhelmscream.com. If you are in the DFW area, we would love to see you at a Fort Worth Film Club event. You can learn more about those and find a full schedule at fortworthfilmclub.com. And you can learn about my foundation and how we are trying to foster the next generation of film lovers at realhousefoundation.org. That's REEL housefoundation.org. Till next time.